Welcome everyone to ITIF for a joint event we're doing today on COPPA, and in particular the discussion of the FTC's new proposals to strengthen and make new additions to Child Online Privacy Protection Act. And we have a really great panel today, a number of scholars and advocates who've written and thought extensively about how that framework should work. And so we're looking forward to a great discussion, which will include you all at the end. We'll adjourn here precisely at 1:30. For those of you who want to tweet, we have a really clever hashtag called COPPA. So if you want to tweet, you can do that. Or we could have had a hashtag Child Online Privacy Protection Act, but we won't be anymore. So I'm going to turn it over here to our moderator, Stephen Balcom, who is very well positioned to lead us today on this. So Stephen is the Chief Executive Officer of the Family Online Safety Institute, which is an international nonprofit organization here in DC, whose mission is to make the online world safer for kids and their families. Prior to FOSSI, Steve was the founder and CEO of the Internet Content Rating Association, or ICRA, as you would call it, and led a team to develop the world's leading online content labeling system. So with that, I'm just going to turn it right over to Stephen, and we'll take it away.
Well, thanks very much for that kind introduction, and thank you very much to ITIF for hosting us today. I've just had a request before we get started, if people could at least mute their phones, certainly not turn them off. God forbid, in D.C. we would turn our phones off. But and if you are tweeting, we have COPPA, as you just heard, and we're also live streaming. So that is going out on the ITIF site and also on the Tech Freedom site. Baron, is that correct?
I believe so.
He believes so. Good. All right. And this is, so it's a co-hosted event with ITIF, Tech Freedom, and ourselves, the Family Online Safety Institute. So welcome. I hope everyone's had a bite to eat. And we're going to have a good, robust discussion here. There's no speeches, no PowerPoint presentations. We're going to get straight into the discussion. And we very much want to hear from you as well. And we're going to try and bring in questions and comments from folks who are looking in on the live stream. So if you do have questions and you're outside of the room, please send them through on the COPPA hashtag. So let me just begin by some very brief introductions. Their very remarkable bios are linked to from the invitation that you all received, so please look them up. First of all, to my left, Dan Castro is a senior analyst here at ITIF. Next to him, Emma Lanzo, who's policy counsel at the Center for Democracy and Technology. Then next to her is, where have we got Baron? Baron is the president of Tech Freedom. We then have Morgan Reed, executive director of the Association for Competitive Technology. And then last but not least, Alan Simpson, who's the vice president for policy at Common Sense Media. So just wanted to begin with little tiny bit of historical background so that we're all on the same page when we start talking about COPPA. The Children's Online Privacy Protection Act of 1998 took effect 2 years later in 2000 and applies to the online collection of personal information from children under the age of 13. Now, it details what a website operator must include in a privacy policy when their service is directed to children, when and how to seek verifiable consent from a parent or a guardian for the collection of children's data, and what responsibilities an operator has. And by the way, that word operator is an important one, and we're going to come back to it in the discussions. What responsibilities an operator has to protect children's privacy and safety online, including restrictions on the marketing to those under 13. Now, in September of last year, 2011, the FTC sought public comment on proposed amendments to the COPPA rule, and then in August of this year, the FTC published a supplemental notice of proposed rulemaking. And I believe there's been nearly 100 submissions in this latest round. I believe everyone at this table has put in a submission. Many of you sitting here have also done so, and I think many who are looking in on the live stream have also done. And I would encourage you to go and have a look at those. Baron, I know you were posting some. I think ITF, a number of us have posted them. It's very easy to find, and obviously at the FTC site as well. So I'm going to begin from my left, and we're going to work down, and then we're going to work back up again. Dan, let's start at the 35,000-foot level view. And how does ITIF view COPPA? And, you know, what do you think the latest series of proposed changes, how will they impact it? But let's begin with it. Do you think COPPA is even working? Why don't we start there?
Right. And let me borrow that mic for a minute. Share over here. Thanks, Stephen. So overall, I'd say the main problem I see with COPPA is that there's been so much focus over the past 12, 13 years on implementation and not a lot of focus on evaluating what the net impact of COPPA has been. I think overall, if you look at the internet and you look at the websites that are out there, you can see the COPPA, which applies to sites directed at children, then you have the rest of the internet. And when you look at these two groups, you can see that there are some clear distinctions between the two. There's distinctions in terms of the quality, the type of content, even the types of business models that they use. So, for example, in our filing that we did, we looked at the top 10 most popular kids sites. Out of those, there were about five of them that are relying on membership fees as opposed to the typical kind of free access to content that you see on the rest of the internet. And the problem that I see with the new rules that were proposed both a year ago and then the recently modified rules is that they're targeted at reducing more targeted advertising. That's really what the ultimate impact of this would be. And so if you look at the internet ecosystem specifically for children's websites, you see that not only have we had kind of stalled innovation over the past 12 to 15 years, we're actually going to prohibit more in the future. So that's kind of the main overall problem that we see with it.
Emma, opening comments. What do you think about COPPA?
Thank you.
This is the problem with opt-in.
Baron's getting his jokes in.
We've got 3 minutes.
So I think we can all appreciate COPPA's goals of preventing predatory data collection and marketing practices aimed at children and increasing parental involvement in children's internet use. But a key has always been figuring out ways to do that that also maintain the internet as a platform for innovation, free expression, and access to knowledge for all users, children, teenagers, and adults. One of the key issues that has come up a lot in the COPPA debates is what age range of children does the COPPA rule cover. I think we may have all, many of us have participated in some robust discussion over exactly what age range it's appropriate to require parental consent for collection of information from minors. COPPA currently applies to children under 13, and it seems pretty clear that the FTC isn't interested in increasing that age range. But another key question has been, because COPPA is a statute that does require operators to treat some internet users differently based on how old they are, one of the questions has always been, how do you implement that? How do you have operators obtain parental consent for children under 13 without asking for more information from users over 13 without putting burdens on operators who have no idea how old their users are? So in terms of some of the most recent proposals that the FTC has made, CDT has been fairly concerned that the expansions of the definition of directed to children and kind of muddying of COPPA's actual knowledge standard that requires operators who know that a specific user is a child under 13. We see some of the changes as kind of shifting that actual knowledge standard into a more constructive knowledge standard that we think really raises the uncertainty for website operators about whether and how they need to comply with the rule.
Okay, thank you. We'll go into more detail as we come back up the table. Baron, opening thoughts about COPPA.
Yeah, so I've been engaged in this now for 3 years at the FTC. Even before the FTC started its rulemaking, there were efforts at the state level to expand upon the model of COPPA that Adam Thier and I wrote about in our COPPA 2.0 paper. And I've had time to make my peace with COPPA, which is to say that I think that it's a pretty good example of targeted legislation that can deal with a real problem And so in principle, I'm fine with that. The question is whether COPPA breaks if you try to expand it. And I would suggest to you that when you really start to walk through COPPA and understand how it works, you quickly see with the definitions that we'll be talking about today, which may seem to be arcane about knowledge and what COPPA, what sites COPPA covers, that in fact COPPA really is trying to strike an exceedingly delicate balance between the interests of children, protecting privacy, empowering parents, and practical and constitutional constraints. And so it's in that sense that I think the best way to think about COPPA is that it is really the Rube Goldberg contraption of internet law, which is to say if you break any one of those things, if the marble doesn't wind up getting all the way through, it doesn't work. And when I say it doesn't work, again, I think what we should do is we should look back at first of all, the goals of COPPA, which were laid out pretty clearly in Senator Bryan's original statements about COPPA, which were basically about enhancing parental involvement, maintaining the security of kids' information, and protecting children by limiting privacy without parental consent, but also promoting the interactivity of children's experience on the internet and children's access to information. So when you start with those goals, and when you realize that there are the constitutional constraints that we'll be talking about today that start to be implicated when COPPA covers general audience sites, which happens not only if you raise the age standard, but also if you change those standards about which sites are covered by COPPA, you start to understand that COPPA, as it exists today, before the FTC's proposed changes, may really be the most that COPPA can do, and we shouldn't try to make COPPA the one-size-fits-all solution for privacy for kids, because we really risk breaking it, and by that I mean the FTC risks winding up in court and losing. Or Congress may end up revisiting a statute to undo some of the changes that the FTC is proposing to make.
Okay. Morgan, opening thoughts.
You know, a lot of the comments so far have talked on the broader picture of constitutionality, questions of efficacy, does the act cover it, and we'll get into those. But I think there's an interesting synthesis here. You heard from Dan's opening point down the line, and it's one that concerns my members the most, and my folks are the small educational app developers who make the cool apps that are on your tablet device that teach kids how to do math or help them with their spelling. And some of it's really amazing tech, and it's driven by really small businesses, mostly parents and educators, who are trying to adapt this new technology to children, kind of in situ. How do I make this happen in real time? And so one of the concerns that really is coming to the fore with our members is obviously cost. Using the FTC's own numbers from their supplemental rule, it's about $271 million that they expect we'll need to pay to lawyers that we won't be paying directly to developers. And that's their numbers, not ours. But the other part, and I think was very interesting, this came out of a speech that Commissioner Ramirez gave at KERU, and I thought it was a really good speech, and she hit a lot of really great points, but I saw the pivot that we heard from Dan when she said, the real failure of COPPA is not COPPA's rules, it's that industry has failed to serve the under 13 market. Okay, so valid, and you just heard Dan kind of say that there isn't a lot there. But my question with this rule is, to borrow from the old motivational poster, are we looking at this from the perspective of the beatings will continue until morale improves? And so what I'm concerned about is that if the FTC's goal is to actually get industry to do more to serve those under 13s that my members are doing, is the right approach to tighten the thumb screws down on the rule setting? So I think as we look at this, we really have to balance with what Commissioner Ramirez said in her KERU speech, which is accurate. Industry needs to do more, and ask ourselves the question, does this supplemental notice of proposed rule lead my folks and the platforms that we depend on to do more of what she says we need to do? And so I want to make sure that it isn't one of those beatings that will continue, and instead something that actually encourages us to do exactly what she wants us to do.
Great. Okay. And Alan, your initial thoughts on where we're at?
Yeah, there's a lot we're obviously going to come back to in all of this. But I would say to your broad question, is COPPA perfect? Of course not. But is COPPA working? I think it is. There are a lot of things that it has brought. There are a lot of things that it has changed. And I agree with Barron about the general principles that COPPA is about. But to me, they summarize much more easily as keep parents in charge. Help parents stay in charge of what is going on with their young children's lives online. And that's crucial. And what's also crucial is keeping COPPA up to date to reflect what's changed in that online universe since the law was passed in 98, when same year Google was being started. The rules were passed in 2000. YouTube didn't exist. Facebook didn't exist. Smartphones didn't exist. And as an organization, Common Sense Media, one of our foundational principles, most of our work, we have two people who work on policy. We have 70 people who work on education, advice for parents, tips for teens. And we love media. There's a lot of great stuff out there for kids, for their entertainment and their education. And like the others on this panel, we want that to continue to flow. And I don't think COPPA is a real barrier to that at all. And I'm sure we're going to dig into that part, too.
So, Alan, let me just go back to you and then maybe work back down the table. You've obviously seen a number of the submissions and the comments in the press. And so what would you put your finger on as an area of consensus at the moment around COPPA? Or do you see any areas of consensus here?
Oh, I actually had more time to review the comments from my fellow panelists, and I think there's some very constructive points that they've made about how to improve this. I think we've discussed some of the consensus, and it's a tension and a consensus. We do want a thriving internet arena for young kids. And I think we all want to help parents maintain their role as gatekeepers. So that's what I'd say is the basic consensus. And then we obviously have a lot of points of respectful disagreement.
Okay. Morgan or others down this table, any other areas of consensus that you see?
Yeah, I think in general, especially with what we've heard from the parents that we've been working with who are trying to develop these apps, there is a lot of consensus around the overall concepts that COPPA is trying to do, which is, as Alan points out, how do we put the parents in charge? How do parents become more in charge of the information that they're willingly sharing about their young children? And so I think the transparency aspects of it, figuring out how do you better inform parents, are absolutely areas of huge consensus. The real question is that how do we police that transparency?
Yeah. And just to be really concrete, in every one of my filings, I've repeated the initial 4 points that Senator Bryan made, which I think we all agree on. I just mentioned them. I think that other point that I mentioned, which is not in that bulleted paragraph, but is also in the original statements in Congress, is really important, which is about preserving the interactivity of children's websites. And I think that's really the tension that you're going to see today. And since we seem to be wrapping up on the consensus section, I'll just mention that today's news, I think, is a pretty good example of that tension, where you saw that McDonald's today had been the subject of complaints about their Refer a Friend program. And McDonald's finally responded today by saying, fine, we're just going to remove that interactive functionality. So this is just, and this is one of many, many examples, and really it's the tip of the iceberg, because what you're not even seeing are the many sites out there that have decided just not to include that sort of functionality at all. I used to do COPPA counseling for small companies that had small websites like local broadcasters. And the basic advice that we unfortunately had to give them is it's probably not worth your time. It's just too difficult. So at the end of the day, where I really have to disagree with Alan is about reality, which is that, you know, it's all well and good to talk about, you know, COPPA's intentions, which are noble, but it does have an impact, because it means that there's a high cost to doing this. The liability is potentially growing. And at a time when the internet is fundamentally changing to one in which you have multiple platforms and plugins operating on a single page, you more and more see this tension and this trade-off, where sites are ultimately having to decide, do we want to even try to serve the kids market at all? And if we do, are we going to just cripple functionality, which is unfortunately more and more where sites are going. So to me, what success would look like is, to get back to consensus, is balancing that goal of interactivity and innovation and offerings for kids with those other goals about parental empowerment and protecting privacy and security of kids' information.
Great. Okay. And let's test any more consensus. You guys agreeing with everything?
I mean, just that I think, as we've all heard, that I think there's a general consensus that the information collection environment online is quite different now than it was in 1998 when COPPA was passed, and that figuring out how to balance that is going to be a very kind of complicated process that involves weighing a lot of different concerns. But I'm not sure that there's as much consensus on exactly what the right balance is.
Anything else to add, Dan?
Yeah, sorry. We're short of mics. I just wanted to build on both what Morgan and Barron said, because I do think the intent, there is a lot of agreement on what the intent of COPPA is to protect children. And I think that one of the important things you can see from that is if you look at what the private sector is doing outside of COPPA, there is a lot of active engagement on doing things that go beyond COPPA, and that's what's actually helping children the most. So you have things like the trustee seals and other types of certification for websites. You have things like actual moderated chat rooms, which is, this is all things that are actually very important in keeping kids safe online and protecting kids' privacy and making sure that no personal information is shared in harmful ways. But these things aren't part of COPPA. These are things the industry is doing on its own. So I think it's important that we kind of recognize that there's an agreement on goals and there's an agreement on the need to take action. But not all of that's coming from the COPPA rules themselves.
Okay. All right. Well, let's start to get down into the weeds and maybe some of the areas of contention. So there's been a lot of discussion about persistent identifiers. Who would like to describe what the issue is here? Ellen, you're smiling, so.
Oh, I think we all would.
But.
Where to start on persistent identifiers?
What's the issue at stake here? What is it the FTC is trying to do with persistent identifiers?
I think this is a crucial part of the FTC's effort to update the rules to reflect the current environment. And I would go back to let me start by pointing out one crucial area of innovation for kids under 13. We can argue about how much there has been on the positive side. There's been a lot of innovation on collecting kids' data. The Wall Street Journal story from 2 years ago about much more tracking on kids' websites. So there's plenty of innovation in what we don't want to see. But it ties into persistent identifiers and the question of whether they should be considered personal information. And our simple case would be, yeah, of course they should. Because in today's context, a persistent identifier is really somewhat like a social security number. If you see a social security number, you don't know it's mine. You have to connect it to other data to connect it to me. But it's not very hard to do with a persistent identifier. And it makes it much more a piece of information that can be used to contact a young child. So we think the commission's on the right path there.
So before we go any further, just to
start.
And before we hear from you, or Morgan, you can do this. Just for the folks who may be new to COPPA, what is it that we're talking about here, persistent identifiers?
Well, if we're talking about what is a persistent identifier, each device like this has a number that's attached to it so that data can move. There's a couple of different persistent identifiers, to be very factual about it. There's one that allows the cell tower to talk to this device. There's another that ties it into your account that goes to your if you're on iTunes or a Google Plus or anything else. There's a number that's attached to the device so it knows this is the device that's attached to that account. There's another number that that is now used on some devices that's a separate identifier that's per application. But in each case, it's something that says, hey, this is Bob, or rather the device named Bob, and information that needs to go to the device named Bob is at this address, 1234 Mockingbird Lane. But the problem with his Social Security analogy is, and big part I'll demonstrate it is, if I were about to do this, it would be against the law. Barron, would you like to buy my smartphone and have my new identifier and have the identifier that goes with this device? I can't do that with my Social Security number. I can't sell this device or any of the other devices, hand it over to somebody who has a different identifier. That's illegal, and we don't let that happen with Social Security numbers, yet it's very common in the device marketplace. How many of us have had a smartphone that we've sold or given to someone else? Moreover, the persistent identifier doesn't necessarily attach to a person. I have this. My 6.5-year-old, on occasion, will play with this device. It's still my device. The vast majority of activity I do on this device is still me. But when I hand it over to my child, a new number doesn't appear on the device that says, oh, by the way, this device is now in the hands of a 6-year-old. We need to change the persistent identifier. No, that doesn't happen that way. So a Social Security number is a horrible analogy to what a persistent identifier is. However, there are issues around persistent identifiers that we do need to deal with, and those are things that are being attached both by the platforms and the devices and our third-party plugins to make sure that you don't end up with some of the stacking problems that are really at the core of what Alan's talking about. Right, so Alan's Social Security analogy number is you have one number, and then you stack a bunch of data on top of it, and ooh, I know a lot about you. We've already made a break from that. As I said, If you do advertising, you have one persistent identifier on here. If you're monitoring it for analytics, you're going to use a separate one, by the way, and you can't share that with another person. You're really getting to the point where we're already splitting persistent identifiers out by either app or by platform or by use to such a degree that the stacking world that Alan sees is already last year's model. And the industry is already moving to a different place on that. So it isn't a Social Security number. It is an important number that we need to take responsibility for. It's just one that we're trying to handle by segregating it out and walling it off a little better.
So let's just be clear, first of all, what we're talking about here. The thing about persistent identifiers, including IP addresses, is every query to any website on the internet involves sending a persistent identifier. That's how the internet works, because otherwise, if you didn't have that, you wouldn't know, the server wouldn't know where to send the packets back. So the problem that we're talking about here is essentially by making IP addresses, personal information covered by COPPA on their own, right? Because right now they are, if they're combined with other pieces of personal information. But if you make them covered by COPPA on their own, you put websites in the impossible position of every single interaction that they have with the child is sending that PII. Okay, that is a fundamental change in how COPPA works. And I think it's not even clear whatever you think of that as a policy matter, it's not even clear that that would survive in court for a number of reasons, the most obvious of which is the fact that the COPPA, the statute itself, says that this has to be about contacting a specific individual. That's the word that's actually used. And for the reasons that Morgan just explained, I don't think that argument's going to fly in court. If the FTC does end up maintaining this definition, I guarantee you there will be a legal challenge. I'll be writing an amicus brief. I hope that my friends at CDT will join us, as we've joined many times before, in arguing for the consequences of this. Because this is, just to be clear, this is not about just defending online advertising or data collection or anything else. This is just the basic framework of how COPPA works and when its requirements are triggered. So again, I would just refer you to the FTC itself has already been down this road once before and very well explained that persistent identifiers should be covered by COPPA when they're combined with other information, but not at that initial handshake that happens between your computer and a server when you just request information from a web page.
And so whether we sign on to that amicus brief will depend in part on what it says. I think it's important to note that as the commission is proposing adding IP address and other persistent identifiers as personal information in COPPA, they have acknowledged comments that CDT and Tech Freedom and many others have made about this kind of the impossibility that it would put operators in, the impossible position they would be put in if IP address were just flatly included as personal information, because it would be completely impossible to obtain parental consent if you were violating COPPA the first time a child came to your website. And the commission has recognized this, and so what they're trying to do as they're adding IP address as a kind of standalone category of personal information is create this exception if the IP address or other persistent identifiers being used for the support of the internal operations of the site or service. And they have several different description of what would count as one of these internal operation exemptions. So it's I think, an open question about whether they've kind of captured all of the necessary and beneficial uses of IP address. You know, there's a lot of things that you can do with a persistent identifier on a website to improve site functionality, to understand how a user is using the website so that you can, you know, improve and respond to their experience on the site in a way that doesn't involve cross-site tracking or any of the, I think, more concerning uses that they're trying to stave off, but that are still really tied into creating and maintaining rich content for children on sites that are directed to children. So it's, I think there's been a lot of debate over whether either the exemptions that they provide cover enough activity or whether they cover too much activity. I think some who have been critical of the support exemption think that there's enough of a loophole there that it will still permit most of the tracking that the commission is trying to prevent. So again, it's a complex issue, but and then the question of whether this will hold up under statutory review at all, I think it's also something I have to consider.
And I would only just mention here that this problem, remember, it's not just about sites, it's also about plugins, which is something we're going to talk about shortly, that the FTC is proposing to cover those in a way that they have not been covered in the past.
Yeah, I wanted to do a quick follow-on on that. She raises a very good point about the exemption for internal uses. We loved it. We loved the original version. We there were some concerns with it, but we loved the idea of what it was doing. And we sat down with the FTC in between the two notices and really talked through it with them. And they get it, right? They are trying to achieve some kind of balance. I mean, there's no question. The staff that are working on this are trying to find a balance. The problem was, what Emma pointed out, was that there was this feeling that, well, they would give us, industry or educational app developers, too much if it went too widely. And so they added a line at the end of it, and that's really become the real problem. It goes through the exceptions, all pretty rational, and then it goes to the end and says, for no other purposes. End of sentence, period. And the problem that creates with innovative technologies and looking forwards is we now know exactly the world and scope that we will live in forever, because we have been told, and for no other purposes. There need to be some modifications to that to deal with the fact that the world is going to change, and given the fact that it was 1998 when COPPA first came out, and now we're in 2012 when we're revisiting it, I don't think we can wait for another revisitation of it to keep up with whatever innovation happens in that space. So the idea of an exception and some exemptions for internal uses makes sense, not speaking to the constitutional aspects at all, but we need to be very careful that it doesn't become a proscriptive document rather than descriptive of the kinds of activities they want to provide for. That makes sense. Hey, guys, these are the things we're thinking about when we describe it. Instead, they said, these are the only things that
okay.
you can do.
So just to be clear, that there are then two options. One is you try to fix that issue that Morgan and Emma just explained, and the other is you simply leave that definition out. In other words, that persistent identifiers would be covered by COPPA only when they're combined with other pieces of information.
Necessary to
right?
contact a child.
Exactly, right. When they're used to contact a child, as Steve says. So now, if that sounds like a giveaway to industry, it's worth noting that again, persistent identifiers can be covered by COPPA. And furthermore, that industry has already said that they are, through self-regulatory principles, that they're prohibiting the behavioral advertising of children. So I'm not sure what this debate is about. What is it exactly we're trying to go after here that COPPA can't already cover with its existing definitions?
Okay, hold that thought. Dan, before we shift gears, did you have anything else on persistent identifiers?
I don't want to spend too much more time on this, but I think this gets back to how we see the rules are being implemented around specifically this one idea of how do we increase this narrow goal of privacy without looking at the bigger picture. And that's, I think, the unfortunate consequence of how the rules have proceeded over the past 14 years, when the goal, even as stated, as Baron mentioned earlier, the clear goal of COPPA is to protect privacy while preserving these other goals. And that's, I think, the key issue
right.
we have to keep in mind here.
All right. Well, thank you. So let's move on, because we have a lot of material to cover. Emma, I want to come to you on some of the key legal standards that are described. I'll just throw a few of them out. The knowledge requirements, reason to know, use of demographic evidence, the notion of directed to children. Do you want to talk about some of these and where perhaps there's some concern?
Sure. Let's see, which one to start with? I guess let's start with one of the proposals that the commission made in terms of the definition of when is a site considered directed to children. To give a little bit of background, I think it's fairly uncontroversial to say that at least in how the commission has implemented or enforced COPPA over the past 12 years, it's really focused on a fairly narrow category of sites that are aiming their content at children and primarily or mainly at children. Not really looking at sites that have kind of an appeal to all minors or to children from ages 10 to 16, really focusing on the sites that are under the facts and circumstances test that the commission applies to consider whether sites directed to children, really ones that are targeted to a young population and are not likely to be appealing to older people. But one of the one of the changes that the commission proposed in this most recent round in the NPRM in August was, we think, expanding the kinds of sites that they're looking to cover to include sites that are likely to attract an audience that is contains a disproportionately large percentage of children. Now this, I think, kind of muddies the not exactly bright line standard, but the fairly clear line of sites aimed at a very young audience to include these kinds of sites that may be appealing to a whole range of users, many or some of whom might be children. This is going to, I think, really raise the uncertainty that site operators face. If you're running a site that, say, features a celebrity that's appealing to children, or something like ESPN.com, which, you know, probably has many children visiting it who are interested in sports scores and seeing how their favorite teams are doing, those kinds of sites are suddenly going to be faced with this question of, you know, does a disproportionate number of or percentage of my audience, is that children? This is not really the situation that site operators have been in with COPPA for the past 12 years. You know, if you may notice in terms of service of a lot of the most popular sites, or most sites on the internet generally, have a line in there saying that this service is not for children under 13. By not directing their content primarily at children, and by having this kind of provision stating clearly they're not intending to direct their content to children, most general interest sites have found themselves clearly outside of the bounds of COPPA and haven't had to worry about implementing verified parental consent. I think by kind of changing the standard in the way the commission proposes, that is going to change, and I think that's where we've seen a lot of interest in this most recent set of proposals.
Okay, Baron, do you want to follow up on that?
Yeah. So this is what I was talking about when I described COPPA as the Rube Goldberg contraption. When that's not an insult, that's to say actually that that's a compliment to its drafters and to the FTC for having implemented thus far. Because COPPA is the only regulation of the internet in this area of internet policy that has survived without a constitutional challenge. I mean, it's worth remembering that in 1998, Congress passed another law many people often confuse with COPPA, which is the Child Online Protection Act, or COPPA. And I pedantically always correct people who say COPPA when they mean COPPA, because I want to underscore what the difference is. And the difference essentially is that at the end of the day, the courts have held you cannot apply age verification requirements to adults, right? So COPPA, which would have limited access to adult-oriented websites based on age verification, was unconstitutional. So everything that Emma just said, it's necessary, it has to be true, because for COPPA to continue to be constitutional. In other words, sites that appeal to a general audience are only covered by COPPA if they have actual knowledge that they're collecting information from a kid, such as if someone set up a profile and listed their age as being a certain age, that's where that comes in. That's why we have this problem of lying. That's just an unavoidable problem given those constitutional constraints. Now, the problem is that, as we're going to see today, that these definitions we're talking about, it's not just that the FTC is expanding them, it's that the FTC is proposing to apply them to plugins, which another thing that we'll talk about. And in both cases, what they're really trying to do is, for the first time, to extend COPPA requirements to the sites that adults all know and use and love. And that creates huge problems. It's in the case of plugins, which we'll get to, I hate to jump ahead, but it may mean that sites end up simply trying to shut off service to child-oriented sites. You can't escape these consequences, right? You can say as much as you want that this is about empowering parents, but at the end of the day, if the consequence is that sites simply shut off service or cripple functionality, you're not giving parents a choice. You're not helping anybody. And that's what happens when you start to muck around with these definitions.
Okay. Anyone, Alan?
I do want to jump in just a bit on that, and I know we'll get to some of the other issues, but I also want to win the Berkman Prize and be the first person to cite the very fine research by Dana Boyd and her colleagues. And I'll give you a quote from it that I think it's not directly about this as much as it's why we're in this space. From their most recent study: rather than offering parents easy and explicit choices to control how their children's data should be collected and used, as COPPA is meant to do, Many companies have chosen to avoid COPPA's regulatory framework through age-based bans, and we would all agree with that. But I think I might be the only one who's disappointed by that, because I think there's a great deal that operators can do proactively, and you hear this a great deal from the Federal Trade Commission and others now, and not just for children, but for everyone, the ideas of privacy by design, but also the ideas of these companies and operators are in a great position to inform and help parents know that here's what this site does, here's how we might use this data, here's why it's beneficial, maybe it involves advertising, maybe it doesn't, and thereby empowering parents to make smarter choices.
So I actually agree with Alan very much. I'd love to live in a world where we had those radically robust parental control tools so that every site was customizable in just that way. The problem is, in the real world, those things are very difficult to implement. They cost a lot of money. And what we're talking about here is sites that don't produce very much money, if any. So if you want to live in a world where you know, Morgan's actually has members who represent companies that actually build tools and apps and sites for kids, on the one hand, they have to be able to make money doing it. On the other hand, it can't be so difficult for them to do that it's not worth them doing.
Yeah.
So that's the balance we have to strike.
And I want to go to a specific, because I think we all agree with Alan. I think there are two points that are raised by what Alan said.
I didn't expect to hear that.
I do. No, I agree. We all wish that there was a easy breezy way to do government-approved, verifiable parental consent in a way that instantaneously allows everyone to know who the kids are, and that it's completely either cost or low cost barrier to entry. But I'll give an example of the problem that the cost creates. One of our members is an occupational therapist who built an app for kids who have autism. And the app is designed for a child with autism to be able to communicate with their parent in ways that they have never been able to before, partially using predictive text, partially using icons, and using the screen to allow a child who doesn't make eye contact with their mom at all to be able to say, "I love you." And I know that's a heartstring pull, but that's the reality of the app. Her market size for this product, what, 10,000? Maybe? She really does it because it's a labor of love and because she wants to. But the FTC's own prediction on the cost model of this is theirs, is $10,000. Now, Cheryl, my occupational therapist who built this app, who came and scraped together some cash out of her own pocket to hire a developer to put this together, if I have to tell her that on day one, before she hires the programmer, before she field tests an app, before she works with her kids with autism, she has to pay a lawyer $10,000, I promise you her husband will say no. And I can promise that because I asked her. And I asked her what conversations she had with her family before they took on this burden of doing an app with a very, very narrow, specific purpose without this giant Angry Birds-style audience. And so while I understand the pushback is industry isn't doing anything, for the apps like Angry Birds, you know, you might say they have enough money that they could come up with a good verifiable parental consent mechanism. Maybe. But I promise you, Cheryl will not be able to. And the decision she makes will be to not do it. And so I'll go back to my original point about this. Alan says the disappointing thing that we've discovered is industry is not providing good tools and content for under 13. And my question to all of you is the right answer to change that metric, to put the thumbscrews down on industry and restrict more of what they do with the expected outcome that industry will magically start being better and doing more essentially out of the goodness of their own hearts? I don't think that's true. I think we have to find a better balance that encourages, that's got a little carrot as well as a little stick involved. And right now, I'm worried that we're too heavy on the stick side, expecting it to have a carrot outcome.
Okay, Alan, briefly, and then I want to come to you, Dan.
I'm not going to dispute Morgan's position about the carrots and sticks. I do want to clarify, I didn't say there's a lack of content for kids. I think there's been some interesting innovation for kids. I think there's a lack of innovation and content for informing parents.
Oh.
And that's asking for permission is not that complicated.
All right, that's a very different point. That point taken. Dan, I want to come to you now. We're starting to talk about the financial underpinnings of all of this. What do you think these revised rules, if they come into force, will? What impact are they going to have? Let's take advertising, for instance, on the internet. What, from your vantage point, do you think this is going to be a good thing or not such a good thing?
Right. I mean, I think, you know, what we've just heard is that, as there are more requirements put on these sites, there is an increasing need for these sites to produce revenue. There's two ways you can do that. You can charge for access to the sites, or you can have advertising. the advertising model is what's worked for most of the internet. It's obviously critically important for those who can't afford access to these sites. And, you know, we've seen over the past 14 years, it's worked very well. The purpose of COPPA is to protect children. It's not to prevent advertising. And I think that idea is lost sometimes in this conversation. In particular, there's, I think, a lot of the conversation on COPPA has been driven, especially initially, it was driven by people who were opposed to advertising overall to children. That was part of the effort of COPPA. That wasn't all of it. There's certainly other aspects of it. But there is, I think, a vocal minority who think that advertising to children is bad. Certainly, some types of advertising is bad. And I think that's where we need to make a clear distinction. Because, you know, there's nothing wrong with a targeted ad for an anti-smoking campaign. You know, that can be very good. You know, what we care about is, you know, we don't want advertisements that are, you know, harmful to children. And if we make a distinction in the content and not the mechanism, then we can get back maybe to an ad-supported model for children's content rather than where we are today, which is, you know, again, I think if you look at the sites that are out there, you'll see that they don't follow the typical business model of the rest of the internet. I don't think there's very good content out there. I think if you look at the top sites, they're either commercial sites that are tied very heavily to a brand. There are some nonprofit sites that are generally general interest sites as well. And then there's the paid sites. And that isn't a model that will work for us if we want to see a lot of innovation.
Sarah, did you have one?
Yeah, just a historical cautionary tale here. We've been down this road before. Many of the same people that were fighting that fight in 1998 were fighting a similar fight in the 1970s when the FTC used its unfairness authority to try to regulate practices across the economy, from funeral homes to in particular, a ban against advertising to children. And that caused the agency to be shut down by a Democratic Congress and have its funding slashed to the point where the FTC has still, in terms of total employee count, has still not recovered. It was so bad that the Washington Post, which was hardly some sort of right-wing Thatcherite bastion, referred to the FTC as a national nanny, right? Not only because of its overreach in trying to regulate and trying to ban advertising, but because they understood that if you start to ban advertising to children, what you were essentially doing was wiping out the industry in this country that exists to promote and to create content for children. And that the only option, if you do that, is government creating content for children. So, all right, so that's what's at stake here. At the end of the day, we could live in a world where we say, you know what, we don't really care what the costs are, we don't care how expensive it is, we don't care about revenue for children's media, because we're just going to have the government provide that. PBSKids.org is a great site. It's listed in Dan's survey of sites that are out there. I'm glad that exists. But I'm glad that there are other private sites, too. I don't want that to be the only site. And quite frankly, I worry a little bit about the idea that we might actually live in a world where, you know, Disney leaves the business and we leave it up to government bureaucracies to build content for children. Not only because it's probably not going to be very good and not very innovative, and if you don't believe me, just look at the FTC and the FCC's websites. Just imagine what those would look like if those were you know, intended for kids. But also because imagine how politicized that world becomes, right? We end up fighting about everything that Big Bird says, right? We have a debate about what Big Bird is allowed to say and what content can be viewed on sites for kids. I mean, that's why it's important. Just bottom line principles about diversity of media. That's why it's important that we have a thriving industry, which includes people who do have the goodness of their hearts, right? It's the private sector in general. It's from Disney all the way down to Cheryl, right? That's ultimately what's at stake here for me.
Okay. Quick point, Morgan.
I wouldn't exactly say I disagree with Barron on this, because we agree, but I want to note that, in fact, interestingly enough, the vast majority of the folks who are in the educational app marketplace actually don't do advertising. And it's not because they don't want to or even COPPA, but because when you're doing a multiplication table application or something to help with cursive, you're not putting banner ads to ask them to buy, you know, Cheetos. So we actually have a lot of folks who actually aren't doing advertising at all. And so it's really interesting that the rules that are being put in place to clamp down on children's advertising apply in a way that we actually have to act. And our folks, we have 1,200 folks on the Moms with Apps, Parents with Apps area, and the vast majority of them aren't even interested in doing advertising because the kind of app that they produce doesn't have it. And back to both Barron's point and Dan's point, That means we have to have a viable fiscal model that allows us to exist in a place where we don't want to advertise, and evidently under COPPA we won't be able to, but we're putting a burden on top of us because we still need to collect information. We still need to use it for other purposes. We need to do all of the other things that you need to do that look like, smell like, sound like marketing, but aren't. And yet, this rule, in its effort to do what Barron accurately pointed out, ends up hurting our guys who aren't even in the marketing business at all.
Okay. Alan, quick response.
Yeah, a couple of quick points on advertising and where it plays in here. There are other business models. I noted that Dan's comments cited the four most popular websites. I think the fifth or sixth most popular website in the U.S. is Wikipedia, which is not ad-supported. There are other business models, as we've just heard right here. But on the advertising in particular, I want to say two things. One, outside of COPPA, generally about advertising, we have other laws and other understandings in place that young children shouldn't be subjected to advertising because they're not ready for it. And that's in the Children's Television Act. That's also a principle I think a lot of parents agree with. But it's not really what COPPA is about, because we're standing COPPA up as it's against advertising, or the people who want this are against advertising. One of the things I like most about COPPA is that it's what I like to call somewhat agnostic on this. It's designed to let parents decide what's appropriate for their kids. If they don't like advertising, that might be what they worry about. The discussions about COPPA in 1998 also discussed contact with kids. You know, it is what parents want to worry about. Let them decide what's a good match for their kids.
Okay. All right. Good point. Let's shift on now to the issue of third-party liability. Barron, you've been talking about plugins. We'll get to you in a second. And Morgan, I want to talk about analytics, but Emma, let's start first. First, why don't you first of all just describe what you think the proposed rulemaking is suggesting, and what may be some areas of concerns for you?
Sure. So another way that the Commission's looking at changing the definition of a site or service directed to children is pulling in plugins. Those are things like analytics providers, online advertising networks, could be embeddable YouTube videos. Any third party that the first party operator of a site or service directed to children puts on their site to provide content, to help make the site better, by providing analytics data that allows the site operator to understand how people are using their site. What the Commission is proposing is that when plugin operators know or have reason to know that they have been incorporated into a site that's directed to children, those third parties themselves have an obligation to obtain COPPA notice and consent. Now, there, some people who spend a lot of time thinking about kids' privacy issues are in favor of this provision, thinking that, you know, there is a lot of information that can be collected through these kinds of plugins, and that those plugin operators should be getting consent for it. Where CDT comes down on the position, though, is that it seems fundamentally unfair that a third party who, through no action of its own, gets installed or incorporated into a site that's directed to children could, through a fairly vague reason to know standard, somehow suddenly obtain COPPA consent obligations without, any real action on their own. We think that, the first party operator, the person who's deciding to create a site directed to children and who is themselves making the decision of what kind of plugins they want to use on their site, that is the entity, the operator, the person who will be able to know, one, what all of the data collection that's happening on their site, what all of that is, to provide the notice to the parents, because they'll have that relationship with the user. They'll have their own COPPA consent obligations that they have to perform, and they're really the ones who should be liable for this, for getting consent for this kind of information collection.
Okay. Fair.
So Emma uses the word fairness. If you read Epic's complaint or comments here, for once I didn't file a complaint, not yet anyway. If you read their comments, they also talk about fairness, and they say actually they think the opposite. They think it's fair to impose that burden on plugin operators because they're big companies and they can handle that burden. I think the fairness conversation is the wrong way to look at it, with all due respect to both of you. And I think I'm in complete agreement here with Emma. I think the real way to look at this is let's talk about consequences. Who cares about fairness, right? So the actual consequences, what you're talking about is what I think is an unworkable obligation to pre-screen sites and to investigate complaints. So essentially what we're talking about is it's a form of, like with any third party or intermediary liability, it's a form of, on the one hand, it's a notice and takedown regime. So just like in the case of copyright, you know, if you get a complaint about material, you have to investigate it. So similarly, if one of the things that's contemplated in the FTC's rules is that if a site got a complaint saying, well, you know, your plugin is on the following sites, they have to investigate those. Well, as often happens in those cases, the practical reality is they're probably just going to just block it on all of them, right? So if you're especially a rather small operator, you don't have the infrastructure to do that, nor do you really have the incentive to do it. You're not really making money much or any at all off doing that. If the burden is applied so heavily that you end up having or feeling that you have an obligation to pre-screen ahead of time, similarly, you're going to filter. So what would that look like? It might be, for example, if you, let's say you're an operator and you happen to install a plugin, right? It is perhaps possible that a plugin operator could change the way its code works to actually break the plugin on sites that it pre-screens algorithmically. So let's say that it's going to scan for words in the site, in the domain name. And there are ways you could imagine this happening, but I don't think we really want that. I don't think it's going to work very well. It raises all of the same problems that are raised by intermediary liability in general, which is why we have Section 230 to start with, which says, as a general matter under U.S. law, right, with the exception of copyright, which is held through something else and through child pornography, the general matter, sites are not responsible and services are not responsible for what third parties do. And we do that because we know, fairness aside, the practical consequence of any other rule is just blocking. So what that means specifically is breaking interactivity for sites, not just children's sites, but adult sites, which is a problem, one, for the original purposes of COPPA, two, because you start potentially to actually interfere with coverage on adult sites, which I would submit is a constitutional problem, which will be litigated in court, and three, because at the end of the day, this is not just the FTC inventing whatever thinks the right answer it is, but it's the FTC implementing the restrictions that Congress put in place in the COPPA statute itself, which very clearly state that these obligations are imposed on operators and those who operate on their behalf. And if you look again at Senator Bryan's original statement in Congress when COPPA was proposed, he specifically talked about that concept as meaning contractors and subcontractors. In other words, what Congress was contemplating was that COPPA would properly apply to sites that were covering that were directed to children or that had actual knowledge, and as well as to sites that they contracted with, which makes absolute sense. No one here would disagree with. The question is, as a legal matter, whether the FTC is overstepping its authority by interpreting that phrase on behalf of to mean something far broader, to mean I'm a website and I install a plugin on my site, or I just even allow embeds. Does that mean suddenly that those other parties, that those plugin operators are covered? I think the FTC would lose on that in court. And that's, again, going to be one of the things that I would love to write an amicus brief on, but I very much hope I won't have to. I hope the FTC will take the time to think that through and probably to take this out.
Morgan, any other thoughts before we move on?
Yeah, let me break some of that down into practical concepts. Let's start off with the first level. I think there might be a way to solve some of the problems around plug-in and reason to know, but what I think will be very damaging for my members are if these are put in after the fact. If this becomes something that we have to deal with by digging through the FAQ or waiting for smoke signals to come out of the FTC to find out what they mean when they say plugins and what they mean by reason to know. I think this is a case where I think it needs to not be cart before the horse, and they need to deal with the question of what you mean when you say reason to know before the rule comes out. Because otherwise, I think it will be very hard to interpret, and it will create all sorts of lengthy confusion. And frankly, you'll end up with a lot of people who fail to comply, and that's not a good thing. But let me explain what the reason to know thing is, because it's mentioned as a legal standard and as this concept. But let me talk about how the practical matters of how that language is being interpreted right now in the field. Right now, we have two different models of how apps get on your devices, right? You go to a website, and you download it, and you install it yourself, and you know, basically, out of the wild, wild west, you pull an app and you install it on your mobile device. No one looks at it. You don't have any faith or trust in the website that you pulled it down from. It's roll the dice. Now, there's another model, which you're seeing at Amazon and others and other stores. Apple is the most obvious, where you go to a store that curates or monitors and takes a look at for sometimes content, sometimes not content, depending on the store. But definitely, is there malware? Does it do bad things? Is it harmful to the overall ecosystem, the network? Now, here's the problem with Reason to Know. If I'm an educational app for a kid, I'm a multiplication table app, I can't hide behind age gating. I can't pretend to be for over 13. I need to say to parents, hey, this is a great app for your 7-year-old. Now, the reviewer at the curated store sees my app, asks to look at my app to decide whether or not to put it on their store, and I'm saying, hey, I'm directed at kids. I'm totally directed at kids. I'm aimed at 8-year-olds. That's my market. Did I just create Reason to Know for the platform that's doing the right thing by trying to prevent harmful things to get on the internet? Have I just now created a legal standard of Reason to Know for that platform? And without that certainty, I promise you the response of the always uptight, always nervous general counsels who look at liability and risk as their first day when they wake up in the morning, what is my risk? Their answer is going to be no. Do not put that app on there. Do not review whether or not it complies with COPPA. Do not view whether or not it has anything. They're just going to say, no, thank you. No apps for 8-year-olds. And it's not because the app was a problem, but because without a clear way to understand the Reason to Know standard, it is not worth the risk to put that app directed at 8-year-olds on their curated platform. And so ultimately, we need to have that built in, fully baked, before this rule goes out. Because I promise you, the nervous Nellies that are the general counsels of major corporations will not respond by saying, yeah, let's wing it. It just doesn't happen that way. So that's the practical implications of Barron's very accurate legal review of what the of how we face it. So I hope we can find a solution, but that's what we need to do. We need to have some definition so that people can wipe their brow and say, doesn't count for me. And then we can move on from there.
Right. Speaking of moving on, I'm going to come to your questions in a very short moment, and for those live streaming, if you want to send any comments or questions through, we'll pick them up via Twitter. Any quick response to what we've just heard, or should we move on? Because
I'll keep it very quick. I agree with my colleagues about the complexity of these issues, and I think they are that much more complex for the parents who are looking at all of these tools. And I think there's a lack of responsibility on the development side. You see what's going on in these debates. You see app developers saying, we're not the ones who should cover that. That should be the store. The store says, we're not the ones who cover that. That should be over here. What parents see is, I don't know who's gathering this data. I don't know what's going on. Keeping this simple up front, keeping simple information and helping parents make choices would address a lot of these problems. And to the threat that this market will disappear, this will sound strange, but I guess I just have more faith in the marketplace than some of my colleagues. I think there are a lot of people out there who want to develop tools for kids, entertainment tools for kids, educational tools for kids, and who want to be out there in front of kids. And so I don't have the same fears.
I guess I'll do it quick. I promise to be quick. I think he's right. There will be, but I think they're likely to be large vertically integrated stacks of companies that can afford the risk. Houghton Mifflin is going to continue to make textbooks for kids because that's their business model. That's what the industry that they're in. But I think the small guy, the entry point for the small guy is much harder in a world where the risks are much taller. And my last, and this is a pitch, we are doing what he said. We are developing icons and other ways to notify parents in small devices for it. So
we appreciate the fact that they're
saying we need to do more. Just to let you know, we are trying to do more, and we agree with him. We've got to find new ways to inform parents.
Dan, final point.
Yeah, I just want to add on to that because I want to go back to the McDonald's example because I think that's a clear example of a company that, you know, they're obviously trying to do something in this space. So I agree with you, companies will keep trying. But then you have the recent complaint against them where they went and then took down this feature. So the feature was, you know, to email with this feature, people could email their friends a link or photos that they had taken or an e-card that they had created, right? So all of these things are still possible to do. It's not like the COPPA rules prevented that. Kids can still send emails to their friends. But what they took away is the integration of the site. which is now very common on many sites, that within the site, especially if you're using a mobile app, with one click or with a few clicks, you can more easily send this link around, right? So they haven't actually changed the way the internet works. All they've done with this rule and with this complaint is make the sites that are directed at children less effective, less interactive, I think less innovative. So you do have people in this space, and I think you'll continue to have people in the space. I agree with that. But they won't be able to do as much as they were able to do in the past, or as much as they could do in other areas.
Tiny.
I once again agree with Alan. What we want is better controls for parents that are usable. But imposing liability for the actions of third parties undermines that goal. And in particular, would point you to the Future Privacy Forum's comments, where they actually propose specific language as to how a common mechanism for processing parental consent on that sort of platform could work, whether it's a Facebook or a mobile apps platform or a store. It's an excellent suggestion, but the whole key to making that work is making sure that you give those companies an incentive to build that platform in the first place by saying that if you do this, you're not going to be on the hook legally if one of those companies screws up. Right, and that may sound like that's a giveaway to companies, but if you don't have that, those tools are never going to exist at all, and parents are not going to have that choice.
Okay, interesting point. Let's look out here. Yes, we have microphones dangling, so if you project your voice, that would be great.
Speak up, Julie.
And if you say who you are and where you're from.
Yeah, I'm Juliana Grinnell with National Journal. I just had a question about this proposal. I think it was from Disney for creating a new category of family-friendly sites. Some of the privacy advocates have raised concerns about that. Can you guys talk about that or comment on that?
We'd like to tackle that.
Why don't I start, and let me first disclose, Common Sense Media does get some funding from Disney. I don't think that has anything to do with this proposal, but what we did say in our comments is the family site, basically, you know, there are concerns, I think, on both sides about this family sites idea. There are people on the consumer advocacy side who feel like it's a camel's nose under a tent and allow more sites that right now are classified as child-directed to not be classified, so they will escape COPPA. And then there are, I think you'll hear from some of my colleagues here who are concerned, and I appreciate it, that it's more in the other direction. It will bring more sites under coverage. They can discuss that. What we would say is we've supported the idea in our comments with recognizing those concerns, but we're supporting it because we think it creates an opportunity for more parent involvement with what their kids are doing online. The rule of COPPA is parent consent, but I think one of the goals of COPPA and all of these discussions is how do we get parents more involved in what their young kids are doing online. So that's why we have stepped up to say this is an interesting idea.
Other thoughts?
Right, and I think the kind of site that Disney may have been trying to get at is the sort of site that's developed intended for children and their parents to use together, where you're going to have, it's a site that's really aimed at children, but with an acknowledgement that many of the users in the audience are going to be the parents of those children. And you run into, under current COP framework, something of a conundrum where you have that kind of site that the site operator already understands they are in kind of the COPPA umbrella because they're trying to get to children, but run into the issue of trying to do verified parental consent for the 45-year-old parent of a child. That doesn't really make sense. And I think one of the things companies like Disney were looking for was assurance from the FTC that if they did some kind of age screening of those users, they could not ask the parent for parental consent. They could obtain from the parent consent for the child to use the site. I think the challenge, though, with the way that the commission has tried to address this concern, it's with this disproportionate language, this looking at a site that has a disproportionately large percentage of children in the audience. They introduce this age screening idea into that definition. They say, if you think you're under this disproportionate category, if you age screen all of your users before collecting any personal information and then obtain parental consent for the users who identify as under 13, then you're square with COPPA. But because they've framed it rather than being a sort of safe harbor for this one particular subset of sites that are aimed at kids and their parents, but rather as a rule that applies to sites generally, that's where I think you run the risk of pulling in a lot more sites that have a composite audience of children and others, and then introduce this age screening idea.
The key point, of course, there is that the reason those sites matter is that they offer the opportunity to advertise to adults. So the real concern I think that Disney is expressing is that if you restrict advertising on those sites to adults, you, because that's the really profitable thing, you take away the incentive to build those sites in the first place, which I think would be a problem for Ellen.
Yeah.
I just want to throw in, you know, I think this is an interesting example of where it's kind of a problem because of the way the rules were originally written, where the focus was the unit of analysis, in this case, is a website, which, you know, maybe makes sense, maybe doesn't make sense, because the way a lot of these sites are actually structured, you have a parent section and a kids section, but they're still considered one website. That doesn't really make sense, you know, from a regulatory perspective in the end, but that's, you know, that's where we are today because of the rules.
Okay, yeah.
Carl Zabo of NetChoice. I was reading through Commissioner Olhausen's comments on something else, and she had this really good analogy that came to mind, and I'd like to mention it here. It was, she was out looking for clothes, and she realized, wait, I have that exact same dress. It's already in my closet. And shouldn't I go and inventory what clothes I have in my closet before I go out trying to buy new clothes? Baron and Dan, in your years of research on COPPA, have you seen examples of cases that the FTC was unable to bring under existing COPPA law that they should have been able to bring or wanted to bring and that they would be able to bring under this new regulation or under this new rulemaking?
Well, I'll start it off. No, I mean, I don't see examples of cases where I think they should have brought something. Now, of course,
really,
you know, there. You could reframe it another way. I mean, so, you know, certainly, I think the way the rules are being designed right now, they are going after targeted advertising that is on some sites, right? They're going after some practices that are on sites now that might not be allowed in the future. So, you know, in that sense, I would say they are trying to do something. But that gets back to, I think, our original discussion where there is some, I think, fundamental disagreements on whether targeted advertising is beneficial or not, but also what that means for the internet for children.
Yeah, I mean, it's on some level, it's an impossible question to answer because I don't know. I haven't been at the commission. I don't know what cases they've considered. But I will say that the commission's brought a lot of COPPA a significant number of COPPA enforcement actions. It doesn't seem to be a tool that's inadequate. And furthermore, again, it's once again important to remember that the online advertising industry has already said that they're not going to do behavioral advertising to kids. So that's something that if a company that certified to those codes of conduct violated, that's actionable under Section 5. That's not a COPPA problem. So that is to say that COPPA is not the only toolkit on the table. There are other ways of dealing with these problems. So I'm not clear what exactly the problem is today.
Okay. I actually have had one sent in to me here. If this goes through, will sites need to re-permission existing users?
Well, you're looking at me.
That's a problem that was raised in a number of comments. A number of comments pointed out how problematic that would be and how the practical consequence of that may be, as in many cases, simply to delete existing user profiles. I mean, the general reaction is it's an expensive burden and there's not a lot of benefit to going through the hassle of that. So that and it may cause many sites to simply pull out of the marketplace. There are a number of proposals for grandfathering in existing users and profiles and accounts, which I think generally is a good thing. I would also say that if you look through the comments, you'll see a number of parties calling for phasing these requirements in over a six-month window. I'm very nervous that the FTC is going to just come out with a set of rules that they consider done that really aren't, that don't address a lot of these questions, and that are going to raise a lot of very obvious practical challenges without any clear recourse. And again, I think that may wind up in litigation, but at least if you had grandfathering in some gradual phasing, you would on the one hand avoid the most obvious problems with past users and also give sites a chance to actually figure out how to deal with some of these requirements and which ones really prove not to be practical.
I think coming from the app perspective, it's an interesting conundrum that I think most people don't understand. You all know that if you delete an app off of your device, I don't know that you've done that. As a developer, I don't have information when you keep an app on your device. You may keep using it, and maybe not, if you're not giving information back to me. I just know you're not giving information back to me. That assumes I collect. So the problem that we have is that we don't necessarily know who's an active user at any given moment in time, even to remove them from our database, if through deletion, or even to seek re-permissioning. So there are some practical matters for us, just as nuts and bolts developers, on how do we deal with this question, because I don't actually know. That's the irony. Here we're talking about identifying kids and identifying people. You'd be surprised how little we know about what you're actually doing. We know some stuff very well and other stuff we don't. So Baron's point is accurate, and Dan's point. We'll have a lot of kind of nuts and bolts programming stuff that we'll have to go through to deal with repermissioning or dealing with existing information in our databases already, where we might not know it's an under 13, but our app is aimed at an under 13 crowd, so we have to treat them that they are, but what information do we collect? It wasn't connected to anything. Ugh. So yes, from the programmer perspective, we're going to have to do a lot of work, and that's just the reality.
All right. So we've been mostly been talking about domestic issues, but we've just had a very interesting tweet and question from the AE forum. What risks or implications for multinationals to have different standards in the U.S. and the EU for parental consent? Any of you considered that as an issue? Emma, I know CDT is working increasingly internationally. What have you been hearing out there?
Well, we know that Europe is currently reviewing its data protection regulation, which is its, well, currently is a directive, but they're looking to turn it into a regulation, which has a bit more directorial force on what member states can do, but that's their kind of comprehensive law covering privacy in the EU. It's, I think, one of the questions that we have to look at as the FTC is reviewing the COPPA rule is what effect will it have on companies overseas if the FTC oversteps or makes, proposes too burdensome of regulations, what kinds of effects will that have on domestic companies, but also companies from abroad who operate in the U.S. If the FTC doesn't address some of the key concerns that are being raised, though, it's not clear that Europe will forbear.
Okay. Mark?
So as the practical guy, we actually, we've had quite a bit of experience with the international question in trying to figure out how to provide transparency. As I said, we started on the icons and notification transparency for parents. Several of the board members, in fact, the guy who did the first version of the icons was out of Sweden. I hope I said that right. Some Scandinavian's going to come after me if I did it the wrong way. Tor worked out the original version, and our board actually has folks from Europe who are in the Kids App space who are part of this effort. And it was fascinating, the difficulty we had finding some common ground on just what we would show and how we would provide transparent information to parents, because Americans have a very different view on what does it mean when we say no ads. You know, do we use a TV symbol? You know, for a lot of these things, we were really hard to try to figure out how do we communicate these ideas. So not only is there the practical matter of different countries having different mechanisms for seeking government-approved verifiable parental consent, there's also a difficulty of finding a way to provide transparency about what we mean when we say what we say in privacy policies and in transparency statements. So it's a very good question. It's going to have a lot of work, and some of it is just plain old practical matters of the way that we have cultural differences between the world.
I don't really have anything to add to the European and global context, but since we're getting broader, I do want to make a broader point about COPPA, which is, thinking about it this week, it really seems strange to me. Common Sense Media works on all issues involving kids and media. We rate and review movies, et cetera, et cetera. I won't take too much time with that. In the policy side, a small part of our work, in the 5 years I've been coming to D.C. to talk to policymakers and fellow advocates around any of these issues, kids' exposure to inappropriate content, any of the different things, sexting, any of these different things, cyberbullying, the universal response, especially from my friends at this table, is parents should be managing that. And we have a law here that was designed to help parents manage what their kids are doing. We have updates that are crucial in terms of keeping the rules up to date with the significant and, in many cases, wonderful changes and innovations that have happened over the last dozen years. And the response here is generally slow it down, water it down. We've got to make up our minds whether our goal here, especially for young children, is to keep parents in charge or not.
Hold that thought, because we only have a... Oh, yeah, all right, we have time for one last question. Go ahead.
Thank you. So my name is Doug Levin. I'm Executive Director of the State Educational Technology Directors Association. We've been working with state departments of education across the country, in fact, encouraging them to make more use of educational digital content online. And I would submit that the traditional modes of distributing instructional materials via textbooks are rapidly falling away to a space that is digital and app-driven. We've talked a lot about the parent perspective. I wonder if the panelists could shed any light on the possible implications for public school systems, whether they be states, school districts, or school buildings who are increasingly looking to these digital and online materials to provide the sorts of apps that you were describing.
No, that's a great question, and in fact, that's something we've been dealing with. The one-to-one programs, and generally, you have a lot of states that are now mandating or pilot projecting tablet devices in classrooms, which, frankly, as the apps guy, I love. Right? I'm totally on board with that. But it does raise questions, because some of the models that we're talking about here would have real problems. Right now, we all think about stores as being the Apple store, the Amazon store, the Facebook store, the Google store. These are stores. Well, guess what? What's going to start happening, and is already, is you will have individual stores for school districts. So there will be a Henrico County store, and the apps that will be provided for the digital devices will come through that store. But that store now is going to have some of these exact same questions. It's going to have to make sure, even with the original COPPA exemption for educators and allowing teachers to essentially function in loco parentis for receiving COPPA or doing COPPA permission, you've now created a whole universe of trouble for the school district itself and how it deals with meeting COPPA compliance under that goal. As far as for educators in general, it is going to be, I think he asks a very good question. How do we make sure that these tools are transparent for the educators? And so is it only come through the local store? Do they allow kids to get an app when they go home? And they say, hey guys, download this great app that you can use to do the supplemental problems that we didn't get to today. Whoops. And the teacher just recommended that app. You take your iPad home, you download it, didn't come to the store, you might have a COPPA problem right there. And the developer of that app might have a COPPA problem. So his question is very valid. How do we deal with the teachers? How do we deal with school systems that are building their own stores and have reason to know and have to follow COPPA? And then how do those provide transparency, not just to the educator, but to the parent, who is essentially the second level of that effort? And I think those are all really valid questions. And to Alan's point about how do we leave parents in charge, well, I think it has to be parents and teachers in charge when it comes to the question of educators.
Definitely. So as a legal matter, remember, as this is what Morgan's saying, COPPA doesn't apply to nonprofits. So one answer might be, well, we don't have to worry about it because the schools themselves aren't covered. The schools can do it on their own. That's not, I think, realistic, because I assume for two reasons. One, in the first instance, that a lot of the services that they're directly going to be contracting for are by commercial providers. In fact, what we want is a thriving industry that serves the educational sector. And they're all covered by COPPA. They have the exact same problems. But even if you thought that it was fine just for these schools or school systems or state or county or whatever to do this on their own, they're still going to have COPPA problems, because they're going to be working through commercial marketplaces that are covered by COPPA, that are worried about the liability issues we've been talking about today. And they're going to want to build in the sorts of plugins and other functionality that exists across the web that are also covered by COPPA. So I think everybody should be paying attention to this. And this is just a great example of where the traditional attempt to avoid the constitutional problems that get raised by burdening purely educational speech, purely nonprofit speech, don't work anymore, because as Dan mentioned earlier, the paradigm has just shifted from one in which we're talking about one website, which is either for-profit or not-for-profit, to a world in which we're talking about platforms where even nonprofit, commercial, non-commercial educational speech is flowing over commercial platforms and is using commercial plugins and tools.
Okay. I'll give you one.
No, you're going to have to. No, we're actually out of time. But what I that's I'm not slow. I've been told we are actually past time. But we have one final question for the panel, and I want you to answer in a response that is no longer than a tweet. Okay. So we will tweet your answers as we go down the line. I'll start with you, Alan. We'll work down. Crystal ball time. What do you think is going to happen? Where are we going to be, say, January, February of next year with this? Do we think or do you think the FTC has exceeded its authority in this, or do you think it's right on target? Alan, come on down.
I think the FTC is very much within their authority. I understand they want to move this year, but beyond that, I thought the Oakland A's would be in the World Series. So.
I am hopeful that we will have a rule that works for everyone, but not hopeful that that will be met by the end of the year. I think that's on it.
It's also on Haiku, I think.
Yes.
It was a limerick the first time you did it.
Rushing this through will break the Rube Goldberg contraption, and there's no reason this has to be done before this chairman leaves. The FTC should take the time next year, probably to hold a workshop to discuss these things and issue a revised rule. And my second tweet, if they don't, they will be sued.
There will be lawsuits.
And I take no delight in saying that. That's unfortunate.
Huh. Okay, thank you. Emma.
Or a shorter version, I think we will see something by the end of the year, whether we're in litigation or third comment round in January and February, depends on whether it's a final rule or another round of notice.
Interesting.
Thanks.
Lastly.
Okay. I think that there is a risk that if we move too fast, and I'll use the president's line here, we're going to be saying in a year, the 90s are calling and they want their websites back.
That was the tweet of the day, so thank you for that. I'm just going to wrap up by saying a couple of things. Actually, a shameless plug for our own event coming up in 3 weeks' time. We actually have just secured FTC Commissioner Brill, who will be speaking, and we also have a privacy panel that will include Aaron Egan from Facebook and Jim Helper, who's been around this issue for longer than most of us have been alive, I think. So that's November 14th and 15th. I want to end with some thank yous, obviously, to ITIF for hosting us, Tech Freedom, our joint co-host, and to these wonderful panelists. Please, a round of applause for these guys.